Jon Snow, the 998th Lord Commander of the Night's Watch, awakes from a vivid wolf dream. With the Lord Commander's tower burnt out and Stannis Baratheon occupying the King's Tower, Jon has taken up residence in the Armory. Stannis is proving a restless monarch during his stay at Castle Black, and spends most of his time investigating the various abandoned forts along the wall and sending envoys to treat with northern lords. He wants Jon to grant him the unused castles and lands of the Watch, so that he might bestow them on lords and knights in his service. Jon is grateful for Stannis' assistance against the wildlings, but argues that he has already ceded the Night Fort and parts of the gift, and intends to re-garrison those castles with men of the Night's Watch, so that they may better defend against the gathering others. Stannis is greatly displeased, and threatens to seize the castles by force if they are still empty come winter, and to appoint a new Lord Commander. Despite Jon's objection, Stannis also intends to burn Mance Rayder for oath-breaking, and because his blood holds magic for Melisandre's fires. Fearing that Mance's son and Maester Aemon will be sacrificed soon after, he sends them away to Old Town. Jon sends Sam with them to train as a maester, and Gilly, who is the infant's wet nurse. Gilly's own child will stay at Castle Black under the protection of Jon and Val. After saying his farewells to Sam and the others, Jon names Janos Slynt, the new commander of Greyguard. However, Janos refuses the order twice and mocks Jon in the dining hall to the amusement of Stannis' knights. Jon responds by executing Lord Slynt in the training yard and giving the command to a grizzled steward from the Shadow Tower. Jon watches as Mance Rayder and the Horn of Jorimund are burned before Stannis' wildling captives. Lady Melisandre conducts the execution like a holy ceremony. She declares Stannis the one true king and the champion of the Lord of Light, and makes each of the wildlings burn a piece of weirwood tree and bow before Stannis, before passing through the wall. Mance screams for mercy and renounces his kingship. Jon silences his suffering with a volley of arrows. Bowen Marsh suggests they seal off the wall to deter future assaults, and Jon promises to consider it. Later in the dining hall, Jon comes across his old friends. He wants to sit down and eat with them, but he remembers his father's advice that a lord cannot make friends with his subjects, for one day he may have to pass judgment on them or send them into battle. The next day, he sends the last of his friends away to Eastwatch in the Shadow Tower. Bowen Marsh escorts Jon through Castle Black's food stores, and though it seems very well provisioned, Marsh tells him that even with the gift's harvest and the tributes of northern lords, they only have enough food for 3 or 4 years of winter, and now that they are having to feed Stannis' men and wildlings, they will run out even faster than that. Marsh suggests that they could buy food from the south, though that would require gold and a region that actually had food to spare. Jon has weighed Marsh's suggestion to seal off the wall, but is leaning towards the Ranger's arguments that this would simply galvanize all the wildlings to attack the Bridge of Skulls, or else dig up one of the abandoned castles. It would also prevent future rangings. Jon is summoned to Stannis's war council. The king declares his intentions to march on the Dreadforts, joining his own hosts to the Karstarks and Mors Umber, and using the Wildmen as a vanguard. The Wildling Men as a vanguard. Jon is not optimistic about this plan. He doesn't want the Watch's armory raided, and he feels that he could use the wildlings to man some of the abandoned castles. He suggests that Stannis march northwest to retake Deepwood Mott from the Ironborn, while mustering a host of mountain clansmen along the way. Stannis likes this idea and agrees to lead the wildlings under Jon's command. Jon and his brothers ride to Molestown, where the wildlings have settled. Many of them are starving and begin to curse the crows for how little food they are being offered. Jon tells them that the food is for fighters, but that he will take any men or women above the age of 12 under his command and give them stations or tasks to perform at the wall. He also promises them that they can keep their own gods and will never be asked to kneel. 63 wildlings are swayed to his cause. Jon sends out 3 ranging parties, most of whom are eager to investigate beyond the wall, save Alistair Thorne, who believes Jon is trying to get rid of him. After watching them disappear into the haunted forest, he makes his way to the practice yard and assists Iron Emma train a few of the younger recruits. This culminates in a vicious duel with Rattleshirt. Afterwards, Jon receives a letter from Roose Bolton declaring Moat Cailin recaptured and announcing the wedding of Ramsay Bolton and Arya Stark. Jon is visibly shaken by the news of his half-sister being alive. He tells himself and his brothers that he has no sister and that the Night's Watch is his only family, but the memory of his little sister gnaws at him. That evening, Melisandre tells him that she has seen a young girl riding to Castle Black on a dying horse and believes it to be Arya fleeing the Boltons. She also had visions of Jon's rangers being brutally murdered. Sure enough, the heads of three men are found planted in the planted on spikes outside their wall, with their eyes gouged out. Jon escorts Melisandre, asking her for any more visions of Arya. They arrive to find Rattleshirt awaiting them, and Melisandre lifts a glamour from his body, revealing it to be Mance Rayder in disguise. He tells Jon that he will travel to Winterfell and rescue Arya Stark if he can. Jon leads a group of Black Brothers to swear their oaths at the Weirwood Grove. When they arrive, they find a group of half-dead wildlings and one fearsome giant. It almost comes to bloodshed between the two clans, but the wildling Leathers, who has come to take the Black, manages to calm the giant with the words of the old tongue. The brothers kneel before the Weirwood and recite their vows. Jon kneels as well and prays to the old god to protect his men and his sister Arya, and for the courage and wisdom to be a good commander. The line "realms of men" sticks out to Jon. Afterward, Jon helps the wildling and the giant 1-1 back to the wall, promising them safe passage. He also brings two of the corpses with him and has them placed in the ice cells for future study. A letter from Stannis is awaiting on his return. It states that he has captured Deepwood Mott and gathers support wherever he goes, not just from the Mountain Clans, but from House Mormont and survivors of Winterfell's sacking. His host is now 5,000 strong, and he makes for Winterfell. Jon sends Val north to the wall to seek out Tormund. North of the wall to seek out Tormund. He is offering to settle them in the gift, so long as the peace is kept. He wants to return the Watcher's former enemies. He wants to turn the Watcher's former enemies into a workforce and unite the two warring factions against their true enemy. He also means to rescue the group of wildlings who have fled to Hardhome. However, this causes discontent among his stewards and builders. They fear that the wildlings will soon outnumber Black Brothers, and that Jon is turning over the realm to the enemy. Jon argues that they are all living men, and that once winter comes, they will need to stand as allies or die as adversaries. He also argues that every human being beyond the wall who is not saved will be made a soldier of the others. However, Bowen Marsh, still traumatized by the Battle of the Bridge of Skulls, refuses to recognize the wildlings as anything but monsters. Queen Selyse arrives at Castle Black, accompanied by her daughter, her fool, her retinue of knights, and a banker from Braavos. It seems the Lannisters have ceased all payment of debts, and so the Iron Bank has turned to Stannis for their due. Jon offers guides, horses, and provisions for the banker to reach Stannis' camp, and in return secures a loan from the Bravosi and use of their ships at Eastwatch. This will secure the Watch access to food once their food stores run dry. After Selyse's welcoming feast, a young girl arrives at Castle Black. Jon's hopes for a reunion with his sister are dashed, though, when it is revealed that it's revealed to be Elise Karstark, fleeing a marriage pact with her greedy uncle. She tells Jon that her great uncle means to betray Stannis and begs for his protection. Jon agrees and has Karstark and his hunters arrested on their way up the King's Road. He sends word to Stannis of Arnulf's impending treachery. Jon also manages to bring the Thens into the fold by marrying the Magnar to Elise, thereby securing Elise's birthright. He implores Craig and Karstark to recognize her claim and take the Black, but he refuses. Jon begins to observe a mutual respect developing between Black Brothers and Wildlings. Cotter Pike sends a letter from Eastwatch stating his rescue voyage to Hardhome has commenced. Val finally returns from the north, bringing Tormund and his host with her. Jon negotiates a truce with Tormund Giantsbane, agreeing to allow 3,000 wildlings to pass through the wall in exchange for 100 child hostages and all their gold and treasures, which Jon will use as currency for food. Most of the men and mountain chiefs are outraged by this deal, but seem to calm down when Jon reveals that they have secured hostages from every wildling chief and captain. Nevertheless, Bowen Marsh calls the act treason and accuses Jon of forgetting his vows. Jon retorts that he guards the realms of men, and the wildlings are now part of that realm. On the day of Tormund's passage, Jon has a very strange dream in which he is defending the wall by himself and slaying dead family members and Black Brothers with a flaming sword. The wildling migration from north to south takes all day, but is achieved without incident. Among the newcomers is a skin changer and his boar. Their presence upsets Ghost, and John locks the direwolf in the armory. For the first time since he arrived at the wall, Castle Black is packed to bursting, and there is noise and laughter and music everywhere. That evening, John receives another letter from Cotter Pike. Only 6 of the 11 ships made it to Hardhome, and what they found when they arrived was a bloodbath. The wildlings were eating their own dead, and dead things stalked the woods and waters. Storms prevent them from leaving, and Pike urges John to send a rescue mission by land. Night gathers, John laments, and now my war begins. Queen Selyse and Lady Melisandre both urge John to leave the wildlings to their fate. Bowen Marsh agrees with them, his hatred for the wildlings now more venomous than ever. Only Tormund is in John's corner. While they are discussing the ranging, a letter arrives from Ramsay Snow. He taunts that Stannis and his army have been slaughtered, and promises to attack the Night's Watch and cut out John's heart if Stannis' queen, daughter, and remaining men are not delivered to him. And he demands the return of his bride, Arya. John holds a meeting in the Shield Hall, declaring that the ranging to Hardhome will proceed without him. He rides south to confront Ramsay Bolton with his threats and asks if anyone will go with him. The room erupts with support. As John makes his way to the King's Tower, a scream is heard. 1-1 is attacking one of the Queen's knights. John tries to calm the situation, but is suddenly attacked by one of his brothers. Why? He asks. For the watch, they reply, one after the other, driving their sharp blades into his belly and neck. Marsh is among the attackers. He is weeping. For the watch, John feels cold and collapses. The end.
May I just put forward your nomination to read The Winds of Winter? Because that was great, man.
I need some water.
That was an amazing summary.
How long did that go for? I didn't realize it was that long,
It was about 12 minutes, I think.
But it was pretty good, because it was really animated. It wasn't just sort of this happened and this happened. It was a really great summary.
Well, the whole thing is, it's an overarching view of the wall because John is at the top, so he has to deal with all of these things. It's not like someone at the bottom looking up. It's just this overarching thing, and it's all intertwined with Stannis' campaign. So it's pretty complicated, yeah.
And actually, just the sheer complication of hearing you read all that just in one go rather than reading chapters interspersed in the book just made me realize how complex John's challenges are. And maybe how I hadn't been quite as sympathetic as I should have been to some of the decisions he makes.
That's all.
I mean, it really is. Yeah. He's just keeping those plates spinning in the air between wildlings and Stannis and what's going on in the north. And it's just craziness.
Well, it's cool reading just those chapters because it's almost a novel unto itself within the book. Because it's probably the most unbroken single perspective story in like all the books. I think there's a lot more character development in the first three books, and this book is almost deliberately there's not a lot of introspection in his chapters. It's so much exposition and so much of him dealing with problems and trying to figure out how to fix this unbelievable problem with such limited resources. And I think he does. I mean, I think his day-to-day, his micro sort of decisions are really inexperienced, and that's what causes problems. He's not relating to the men. He's not keeping his ear to the ground. But I think his overarching strategy is really forward-thinking and progressive. He's the only person dealing with this threat of the others. Even Stannis has kind of become consumed with this quest for the throne, but Jon is the only one who recognizes this unbelievable threat and is trying to save as many wildlings as he can.
I found it interesting to read that, I think, second chapter where it's the mirror of Sam encountering John telling Sam to go down to Old Town. I think that when you read that chapter from Sam's perspective back in Feast, and you see how John has seemingly had an abrupt 180 with his behavior and has become this hard battle commander who's doing what he must and such. I really love that we get to see it from John's perspective and see that every time he's doing these things to first Gilly and then Sam, that he's really struggling with it, and that this change is not an easy one for him. And that's really one of the most characterizing elements I felt for John throughout the whole series, even that that he's trying his best, but it's really killing him to do these things.
Yeah, you can see him projecting such a harsh sort of exterior, but inside he's really, he sympathizes with a lot of these people, but he has to, as Aemon says, he has to kill the boy and be the man. And I think Melisandre criticizes him for not understanding the trappings of power, but I think he does understand it to a point, that he has to project, this strength. And he knows that wildlings follow strength. And I think he understands that.
Yeah, his understanding is definitely flawed, but I find that incredibly believable. I mean, this is his first real experience with true power, and I think that the ways he reacts are very much realistic to the to how you would expect to with the experience he has.
I can't believe he's only 16.
Well, yeah, in this book in particular, the way he interacts with people seems so mature compared to, yeah, in some ways, how he was before. And I found that a little bit jarring at first, but, you know, it kind of makes sense with the position he's in. He feels like he needs to be that way, and he's working very hard to put himself out there like that.
But it's also another example, I think, of where the potential of having a 5-year gap at one point. And, you know, there were problems, obviously, with that. So George decided not to do it. But you can see how it'd be slightly more plausible at 22 than 16, even within the world of these books, where young kids do amazing things.
That kind of becomes a necessity with John and the other Stark kids in particular, the fact that they kind of have to age up a little bit despite not really aging up. That's just kind of something George had to do. But with the things they've experienced, I find it believable that since they've had so much hardship, they've been forcibly sped up in their growth as people.
But the thing is, in a lot of places, John does react as a 16-year-old. He remembers his father's advice that you have to know your men. And he does that to a certain extent. He knows each and every person in the Night's Watch. But the thing is, he tries to stay aloof, even though Ned Stark was the complete opposite. I remember in one of Arya's chapters in A Game of Thrones, she discusses how Ned Stark had a different person at his table every day. You know, one day he would have old Nan, and then he would have one of his guards, and then he would have a cannon master, and then the cook, and, you know, just to get to know them, to talk to them, to make them feel important. And Jon doesn't do that. Jon doesn't even eat with his men. And I think that's what really goes wrong, really starts to go wrong.
Yeah, I think it also reflects the younger brother thing that Robert and Stannis have, where Robert was always able to win people to his cause, and he was so charismatic, the same way Rob is in many respects. But Stannis and Jon are all, they're so hard, and they're so, they're all about duty. There's very little charisma to them.
That's exactly what Melisandre notices in her chapter.
Yeah, but yeah, it is interesting that, because I think it is Rob who remembers that Ned taught him to always talk with his men, have one of them to dinner each night, whereas John remembers something different. So I don't know if they're picking and choosing what lessons, or if he actually taught each son something different. Maybe he suspected that John would eventually become a military commander, and that Rob would be a lord, and a lord had to be more plugged in to his people, and a military commander had to be more brutal and harsh with them.
What do you think it is that finally is the straw that breaks the camel's back regarding the coup? Or when do you think the coup actually is planned? Like, do you think that it's just the fact that he was too distant and stiff and was letting Stannis and the wildlings in, and that they were eating the food that did it? Or was it the march to the north?
I think it was the point when he said he would let even the Weeper pass if he agreed to his terms. I think that was probably when they said enough is enough, you know, when Bowen Marsh and company decided that it was enough. Because they couldn't have started planning when John decided to go to Winterfell, because they only had like an hour after that. So it couldn't have started then. It had to have started earlier.
I kind of see it as a kind of snowball, and pardon the pun, as the way it plays out. Just each decision kind of compounds in the other and breeds resentment among the men that kind of just eventually become so big that they have to act, that they've been planning it probably for a while, but that last moment where he decides to go south after making this decision they see is totally ridiculous, to go up with this ranging to hard home, where they see that it's a complete waste of resources and it's leading so many men to their death. I think that's the moment where it kind of all falls apart. But the way I see it is every single bad choice that they react negatively to is building that up.
And it's not just one thing. Do you think they're to blame? Because, I mean, I love John, but I just, on a pure, like, Night's Watch self-interested point of view, I think they were kind of justified. The problem, I mean, you can make that argument. I don't know if any of you have listened to the last What If Part 3 episode of Podcast of Ice and Fire, but they had a quite interesting discussion about this, that what was it that tipped them into acting, and, you know, were they justified in so doing? I was just wondering your thoughts on that.
Well, I don't think they're justified because, I mean, what's going to be the aftermath of this decision? The wildlings are just going to kill them all and take over Castle Black. Aren't they? I mean, they're outnumbered like 5-1.
The wildlings are definitely following Jon right now. And once he's out of the way...
So Bowen Marsh has effectively just handed over the castle to the wildlings. It's the most ridiculous, absurd decision ever. I don't know what the point of it is, because they're completely outnumbered. And John's got all these wildling support behind him. And the second Tormund finds out what's happened, he's going to come down on them with all his fury.
Yeah, everyone always likes to make the Julius Caesar comparison with this, and John being ousted and Bowen Marsh being his Brutus. And I think that in that same way, we get that sense that George R. R. Martin might have written this as a kind of homage, and the fact that Bowen Marsh was in the same way completely delusional to the implications of ousting John, and he's going to, he didn't really expect the result that he's probably obviously going to get, which is that the wildlings will completely take over whatever else is going to happen. I imagine absolute chaos will greet us in the next book when we get that perspective on the wall.
Yeah. The Ides of Marsh.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think, well, I don't know, maybe this is a bit far-fetched, but I think I've heard theories where Marsh has been influenced by the others, that this is a plot to take down John, that he's been amenable to this kind of darkness, and it's sort of seeping into them now. And that's why, it's like, well, he's amenable to it, obviously, because he's so discontent with John, but the others have sort of seized on that and used it to take down the wall, because the others can't breach the wall, but they can sow corruption into the ranks of the Night's Watchmen, I guess. But maybe that's a bit too supernatural for this narrative.
It's
this
possible.
Drama that's playing out.
It's definitely possible. I don't know. I think that there certainly had to be something going on for them to make that choice, which was obviously a bad choice. Because, like you say, I do think they were justified. I just don't think that they went about it the right way, because they're not going to get the result they wanted, which is, you know, a loyal working wall that's doing what the wall should be doing, etc.
Well,
but again,
I mean,
that's a really good parallel, isn't it, to Julius Caesar, where on a narrowly legalistic sense, you know, they were perfectly justified in killing Caesar as a tyrant, but actually what they then unleashed was a civil war that brought to power, you know, an emperor, which is exactly what they didn't want. So I think the idea of them thinking very short term and seeing this immediate threat to the Night's Watch, you know, getting involved in political struggles and just kind of completely unraveling their whole raison d'etre, so they kill him, but then ultimately they just destroy the wall in the process. It's a delicious dark irony.
So you guys agree that they were justified?
I think that they had the right intentions. They just, again, they didn't go about it the right way. That from a purely basing it off the tenets of the Night's Watch, John was definitely in error. He was making the wrong choice, and in a normal situation, that's how they should have reacted. But this was obviously not a normal situation at all. And because of that, they should have not acted as they did.
I guess the kind of one defense is that Ramsay has declared his intentions to attack the Night's Watch, and that rather than wait for him to come and attack an undefensible castle, they go out and meet him in the field.
That is true. I think that the bigger offense in this whole thing is him sending men up to Hardhome and not even having the common, I don't know, courtesy or the stalwartness as a leader to join them in a thing that they all see as a suicide mission. I think that was the bigger thing. To me, that was the bigger thing that I think really forced them or just broke the camel's back or whatever.
That he's sending them out at all, or that he's not leading them?
I think a combination. It doesn't look good, and it really pisses them off, probably, that he's not even going on the suicide mission that he's ordering them to go off to.
Yeah. I don't think Marsh can argue that, though, because it's just wildlings that are going out, and he doesn't care if wildlings get killed. But the thing is, Cotter Pike and all these men are up there as well, so you can't really... There's one thing to say, leave the wildling women and children to die, but it's another thing to say, leave our Lord Commander of the Eastwatch to die.
Right, yeah, it's all of that. Just the whole notion of Hardhome and how it played out, I think, is really the biggest compounding issue. But I guess another good question to ask, I don't really know how to rule either way if it was a good choice by John, but the next question would be, was that letter that spurred him into action even sent by Ramsay? Have any theories?
The question is, does Ramsay Bolton actually know that it was Mance? Because if he does, then the letter could possibly be from him. But Ramsay doesn't strike me as the smartest person, so...
Yeah, but he knows. He knows
is
about Mance.
Stannis, though, so but then Stannis something. Didn't know it was Mance, right?
Yeah, that's right.
I'm assuming Melisandre didn't tell him.
Unless Melisandre sent it.
Well, we don't get the sense that Melisandre told Stannis about Mance. It definitely seems like a thing that she's keeping to herself from that chapter we get of her.
Yeah.
But who's, like, the most popular contender on Westeros? Like, who do people think sent it? Who's the biggest leader?
A lot of people seem to think it's Stannis. Because he wants Jon to come and help him take Winterfell.
Yeah.
You see, I think it's Manderly, if it's anybody, because it's part of that big Wyman Manderly grand...
And Northern Conspiracy?
Yeah,
that... Is he... How could he possibly have the information that's elucidated in that letter, though?
Well, he could figure out Mance was there. He's got probably spies everywhere. Maybe that doesn't make sense, because he probably doesn't know who Mance is by sight. I don't know.
Well, that's a good point. Who knows who Mance is or is aware?
I mean, they had washerwoman. They had the washerwoman around, or the wildling ladies. Maybe they let something slip.
That's true.
But yeah, Manderly could be a candidate as a way of wheeling Jon into the mix, because he wants to bring in as many Starks to Winterfell as he can.
Yeah, and Manderly is definitely one of the people who is actively trying to commit some subterfuge, unlike Stannis, who I think is trying to still sort of have a more moralistic method of going about things. So I can definitely see that.
What about Stannis, or maybe the person Ramsay killed was like a glamoured Stannis or something? And the real Stannis is still out there.
I don't know.
Melisandre wasn't there. Doesn't Melisandre need to be a little closer to keep the glamour up?
Maybe, I don't know. It's just that, because I remember the two chapters the two Asha chapters that have Stannis in them, and it just, whenever she described Stannis, he was kind of, I don't know, there was something weird about him. He's kind of looking off in the distance. I don't know.
She had no experience with the actual, if indeed this was some kind of doppelganger, she had no experience with Stannis beforehand, so she doesn't really have a point of comparison.
Yeah, but I guess he wasn't speaking at all. He was just sitting there. I don't know. I haven't read the chapters in a while. It's probably, yeah.
It could be. I find the whole glamour thing is difficult to rule on, and I think it throws a lot of questions in if people are people or if there's some kind of doppelganger or something like that. I don't know. But right now I'm inclined to believe that Stannis is, in fact, Stannis, and every time we see him.
It kind of makes sense that, I mean, because, you know, Martin's obviously drawing a lot off medieval history, and they would dress soldiers up as kings in the battlefield sometimes. Right. Yeah. I think Richard III, there was like 6 kings that he slayed.
So who knows who's Mance is, and who knows that Theon was Reek, right? Because that's the other giveaway piece of information in the pink letter.
I think everyone at Winterfell knows that Theon is Reek. All the lords, yeah, at least.
Right. He, and in the marriage, he is Theon in that point, right?
Exactly. He's the one. He's basically vouching that Jane is actually Arya because he was her foster brother or ward or whatever. And they,
yeah, they used him to confirm
his word.
Right. Exactly. So they know he's Theon. That piece of information is widely available to the people at Winterfell.
Okay.
Could it be that Ramsay's just lying about killing Stannis? Like, he knows.
Oh, yeah. At the end of the day, we could be totally overthinking this, and this is just Ramsay fucking around with. Sorry, I don't mean to say that, but messing around with John, and I don't know. It could be any multiple things. And again, I think that with the evidence we have at the point of dance, it's really hard to say.
Should we move on to the death of John, the alleged death?
Yeah.
And then I guess the common theory is that Melisandre or someone's going to raise him from the dead.
Yeah, there are multiple.
I mean, Thoris is able to raise someone after 3 days of death. I think Melisandre can raise him after 2 minutes.
We know Thoros can reanimate people, and we get this prologue where we know that you can work into an animal as a surrogate life, so to speak. And with those two things, we could definitely say that somehow Melisandre pulls something out of her robe and she makes
it
happen. But
John works into 1-1.
maybe.
Actually, no, there was a line where he says 1-1 is twice as big as Hodor, but half as smart. So maybe he'll grapple onto 1-1 the way Varamyr tried to grapple onto Thistle. I don't know.
From Varamyr's chapter, I got the idea that it's easiest to work into your wolf, especially a wolf that you've been inside before. So I think Ghost is pretty close by. I mean, it's not that far. So I think it's easiest for John to slip into Ghost.
And
will probably put at least a bit of a fight. So I think it's going to be easier with Ghost.
And he's not actively
trying
to work when he dies. It's going to be some kind of desperate attempt. And in that way, it's probably going to be him. His most reactive instinctual response will be to go to Ghost.
Exactly.
I don't think it would work if he was revived immediately. Like, if that was the case, like, what would be the point of killing him in the first place? I think he's either going to be in, like, a coma situation or he's going to go into Ghost. And then he'll have to be returned to his body, you know, half a book later or something like that. Or he may stay in Ghost permanently and we get Ghost chapters.
I don't think it's going to be a half a book or too long later. But I think it's going to be there's going to be a period of him not being an active force and chaos erupting. But I don't think John is dead. I think that would be a supreme waste of a lot of time, even though there will be probably implications on the level of Eddard and Rob dying in terms of how it affects the overall narrative. But I still think that John, his character, is too invested to just be done at this point.
Bran has this vision of John going cold and freezing or something like that, and I think that probably means that John, it will take some time for John to go back into his own body.
Do you think he could go to the north maybe and try and seek out Summer and Bran as ghosts?
I think Bran's out of the story. That's the way I'm feeling right now, that Bran is not going to have any outside interaction outside of the ways he manipulates his green seeing powers. I think that he is not going to meeting any other characters.
I agree. I think Bran's almost now tree phone, isn't he?
Yeah, tree phone.
He's almost too powerful, yeah.
But
which is weird.
And there's no way
he
can come back.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the middle of winter. Winter has started. There are whites everywhere. How is he going to get back? Even if he wanted to.
True.
Plus, he's probably got roots growing out of his legs by now, so kind of stuck.
What did John and Tormund discuss for 2 hours on the night that John was assassinated? What's up with Hardhome? Did something land there 600 years ago? Was it a meteorite?
Yeah.
Could Lightbringer be cut for it?
Yeah, that's me. I went a bit crazy.
Will John have to find the sword to defeat the Great Other? Oh, it was so exciting just reading the question, let alone trying to answer it. So.
Yeah, maybe I shouldn't admit this, but I've written some like Jon Snow fanfic, like following on from book five. So I've written a bit about it. Awesome. Yeah, I've written about like the Great Other and all that.
You should definitely, if you feel comfortable, like share it as a show note to this episode. Then
absolutely.
So, what's your theory on what John and Tormund were discussing for 2 hours?
I don't think I had a theory for that. I just thought it was logistics of how they were going to handle the attack on Winterfell or the attack on Hardhome.
Oh, okay.
I mean, they're not going to just immediately go to the Shield Home with a plan worked out. They're going to have to discuss it.
Right. I think people overblow that gap as a lot of stuff happening that's really important. But I think it's just, them talking battle strategy or stuff like that. And in the meantime, they were fomenting the coup.
They did the same thing with the Bravosi Banker. They discussed for 2 hours and they work out a deal. And that's it. Like, we don't have to see that 2 hours of haggling.
Thank God. Oh, yeah. And then who put number one? John equates the cold wings with the breath of an ice dragon, like in stories. And is that shit happening, basically?
Well, do you guys remember in book two when Summer sees possibly a dragon emerge from Winterfell?
Yeah, when they leave the smoke or whatever, it looks like a dragon or something like that.
A snake with which its roar is a river of flame. And I thought, Sam mentions in his first chapter Silverwing and whether it maybe laid an egg at the wall. And I thought, maybe it laid an egg at Winterfell. And when it was sacked, it sort of emerged. I don't know. It quickened and emerged.
So when Winterfell burned, it hatched an egg?
I don't know. Yeah. Well,
If an egg had hatched, wouldn't it be approximately the same size as Dany's dragons when they were born? Which would mean pretty small, and so it couldn't be seen from that far away. So it's probably not an egg.
Yeah, the way Bran describes it is something large. So I'm not sure it's an egg, but my initial response is to assume that it was just a thing. Bran was seeing things or whatever, and I feel the same about John remarking on the ice dragon, but you know, I think that there is something to be said for these details and the fact that they aren't overstated and that they could reappear in a more significant way.
Well, old Nan mentions an ice dragon. I thought, you know, she's usually on the money. Maybe there's an ice dragon somewhere in the lands of always winter.
Hey, I'd love it if there was an ice dragon somewhere.
Well, John keeps saying the wind is blowing like an ice dragon. And I thought maybe this dragon is blowing across the Westeros, so that's what's causing these erratic seasons. I don't know.
That makes about as much sense as any other explanation people have come up with for the winter and all that.
I just want to see an ice dragon, basically.
Yeah, I totally.
I just want to see an ice dragon fight Dany's dragons.
And this one seems pretty interesting. If the world is shattered, would the North merge with the Wildlands as a separate realm from the Iron Throne? You know, with most of the northern population being decimated and the Skagosis getting involved in the Tens and the Wildlings.
It would make sense, wouldn't it?
It just feels like the North and the Wildlings and the Wildlands are so much more in dialogue with each other, and the North is just completely cut off from the Southern Kingdoms. Like, they don't even consider it half the time. And if the wall breaks down, which I think is an eventuality once the others attack. Like, my theory was that the others are working. The others kind of like seize Bo and Marsh, and they kill Jon. And now that Jon's dead, who's maybe Azor Ahai, they can finally launch their assault on the wall and break through it. I don't know.
It
seems like they've conquered the whole lands beyond the wall, and now they're ready for their attack. And now that winter's come,
I think it makes a lot of sense. There's much greater cultural affinity between the Wildlings and the Northerners than there is between them and any part of the South in terms of tradition, culture, language, religion, you know, it's, and that kind of intermarriage is starting, you know, that whole process of settling people together under John.
I'm not sure we're going to see the result of the blend between the two, though. I think that we're not really going to get to that point in the story where we see how that plays out. Not least because at this point, there is going to be a lot of contention between the Wildlings Wildlings and the Northern Lords and the Night's Watch, just based on the fact that of Jon's assassination and all that.
Well, I suppose the idea of whether the North ends up as a great Northern kingdom depends on who you eventually see on the throne, whether you think there will be someone who rules all of Westeros in any meaningful sense when this all plays out. Because if maybe
Jon's
up on the throne, maybe there's a chance to keep the North together, but you know, if it's...
I don't see how Jon can get to the throne.
If it's Dany, then... I don't...
That's probably not going to work
out.
I
hope it's not Dany. Anyone but Dany.
Yeah. Well, I think that there's a lot of ways it could go. My ideal happy ending would be, the way I see it, is like them all breaking back up into the Seven Kingdoms and living their own thing. And I kind of like that as the result, but that could be it. It could be they introduce some kind of more democratic thing or something. I don't know, but
I quote Samuel Tarly in one of his chapters: "No happy choices, no happy endings."
Yeah,
and I feel that's George like wagging his finger at us through the page,
and definitely. All the things that he has said about it having a bittersweet ending. The series in general will have a bittersweet ending.
But the way I see it, like that ending I'm talking about them breaking apart, I don't see it as being a fully happy thing. Like, I see there being definitely a lot of contention and issues that get them to that point. But that's kind of like the way I would like to see it end.